Hi there, everybody. My name is Lauren Spring, and I'm an art educator at the Art Gallery of Ontario. I'm so grateful that you've tuned in to join us today for one of our mental health virtual tours offered as part of the Access program at the Art Gallery of Ontario. We have two exceptional works of art to share with you today. But before I do that, I just want to launch into this very important acknowledgement. There we go. So the Art Gallery of Ontario operates on land that is the territory of the Anishinaabe Mississauga Nation and was also the territory of the Wendat and the Haudenosaunee. The Dish with One Spoon Wampum Belt Covenant is an agreement between the Haudenosaunee Confederacy and the Anishinaabe Three Fires Confederacy to peaceably share and care for the resources around the Great Lakes. Toronto is also governed by a treaty between the Federal Government of Canada and the Mississaugas of the Credit, Anishinaabe Nation. Toronto has always been a trading center for First Nations. Great. So the first work of art that I wanted to share with you today is really one of my absolute favorites from our collection. As you can see, it's by Rembrandt, and it's titled Portrait of a Seated Woman with a Handkerchief. Likely painted in and around 1644. Now, a couple of things about this artwork. Typically, when I tour with this painting with a group, one of the first things I'd like to ask participants is what they notice in the painting, anything at all. And some of the responses tend to be quite intriguing. So for example, people often comment on the fact that the woman's wearing all black and wonder if perhaps she's a nun or maybe in mourning. You can also see that she has this really interesting sort of smile playing on her lips. Certainly, I don't think anyone would argue that she's elated or, you know, extremely happy. But certainly there's something quite profound going on psychologically. People also note that she sometimes appears quite masculine. You can see her hands appear to be sort of rough. The features on her face may be a little bit angular. Perhaps the fact that her hair is back, others wonder how long it might be and whether or not that indicates, you know, masculinity or femininity. But time and time again, even in spite of the title, people often say, wait a second, it says a woman, but that looks like a man to me. Also, people tend to note sort of the really incredible play of light and this, I'd say both kind of literal and compositional, but also perhaps psychological play of dark and light. Now, certainly Rembrandt was a master at that. This painting is considered to be part of the Dutch Baroque. And the Baroque period in art, it occurred in several different countries in Europe, but certainly countries like Italy that are most famous for this particular style and were very Catholic at the time had a very different theme in terms of the Baroque paintings that they would be depicting, which were most often in Catholic countries, biblical stories. So you'd have these really quite elaborate, very deeply emotional and moving and tumultuous renditions of drama and biblical stories. Whereas countries like the Netherlands, modern day Netherlands, that were Protestant, they employed this sort of use of light and dark in a lot of these Baroque styles, but tended to focus more on portraiture. When it came to Dutch paintings as well, there's a number of landscape paintings because this was an era where the country was really sort of a trading port for Europe, and so it was one way to kind of communicate how robust they were when it came to foreign trade. And so this does fall into that category of Dutch portrait painting using this Baroque style. Now, one of the things that Rembrandt was so highly skilled at was not only capturing kind of very naturalistically the exterior of someone, a sitter, whatever model was sitting for him, but also this kind of complex interior emotional world. Now, the Baroque period came after the High Renaissance, where artists had really, you know, perfected the art and technique of painting human skin tones and posture and natural light realistically. And then Baroque was almost like the High Renaissance on steroids. Like it kind of took all of that, all of those techniques, and then, you know, pumped up the volume and made things more dramatic. And so what's really interesting to me about this painting is that typically at the time, the portraits would have been by very wealthy individuals. And this work usually hangs in what we call our Dutch Baroque gallery at the AGO. And she's, this woman here is surrounded by portraits of merchants, mostly men, who, you know, would have made a lot of money through trade. And one of the ways of kind of showing off their status at the time was to hire a very famous painter to paint their portrait. They'd get dressed up in their best laces and high heels and, you know, and fancy hats and have a famous artist like Rembrandt paint them. And then they'd hang this in their living space, you know, much like today people will buy a fancy sports car or a designer purse or some huge yacht if they want to show off their wealth and success in some kind of commercial way. During the 17th century, it was quite typical to have your own portrait painted. But this one is a little bit different because this woman is not necessarily particularly wealthy. But there is a lot going on. Another thing that people often notice when they look at this work of art are the objects. And if you look really carefully, you'll see that on her right hand there, she has a little ring. She's also holding this handkerchief, as noted in the title. And then in the back, there's also this book. Now, the Dutch Baroque artists were huge on symbols, and so it wouldn't just have been like, oh, there happened to be a book behind her when Rembrandt was painting this portrait. No, not at all. If a symbol like that is kind of inserted, it means a lot, and it's deliberate. And so while we don't know tons about this woman's life, what we have been able to gather is that she was likely a widow, and so those who note kind of when we first look at the canvas that she has this black dress on and is perhaps in mourning would be correct. The fact that she's holding this handkerchief too does indicate that she's in mourning and you know, has been crying about the loss of her husband. That's also likely the reason that she has this little ring on her finger, was to symbolize what the loss was. Now you might go back to her facial expression and think, wait a second, well, if she's in mourning, why is there sort of this slight little smile playing on her lips? And, you know, the reason for that is because it's actually social in nature. And that's because the Netherlands was one of the first countries in Europe to actually allow a woman to inherit her late husband's wealth and property. And that means that, you know, this woman who's being pictured here, well, she probably misses her husband, and I'm sure he was a stand-up citizen and an excellent man. You know, she's not going to be left destitute. And one of the things I really love about this painting is her body language and her posture. Certainly she's seated. I mean, it's called Portrait of a Seated Woman and doesn't look like the most comfortable chair. And, you know, she is kind of planted in there. But when you look at her body language, there is this almost forward momentum. You can see that, you know, with her right hand there, it's almost as if she's about to kind of push up. Her other elbow, her left elbow, is on the chair too. She's looking forward in a way that, to me at least, indicates some sort of glimmer of hope. Or, yeah, when I look at her, there seems to be something that she's looking forward to. I don't know if in her eyes she's looking at something literal, perhaps out the window. You know, often people think, oh, maybe she's watching children play or recalling an important memory. Whatever it is that she's thinking, I think it's definitely deeper and probably more existential than, you know, what she's going to have for lunch that day. But there is the way that her chin isn't cast down, her eyes are sort of forward-looking. To me, I am comforted when looking at her, thinking, okay, I think she's going to be okay, this woman. I think despite what's happened, there's some sort of survival instinct that's kicked into play here, and that, yeah, she is going to be okay. And I mean, financially, this would have been a huge thing for women, because in other countries in Europe at the time, you know, if one's husband passed away, all of his wealth then was transferred either to his brother or a son. And so widowed women then at that point, you know, would have been sort of, their survival would have been at the whim of a son or a brother-in-law or some other male relative. And, you know, she's slightly more empowered in this case. I think that's part of the reason too, that a lot of people might see a bit of a masculine austere to her. Certainly when we compare this particular portrait to others of the era, women tend to be positioned quite differently. Usually they'll have their arms folded, kind of, you know, kind of folded in on themselves, or they'll have a blanket or a little dog on their lap. Whereas it's really the men who are positioned with this elbow out in this kind of triangular position of power. And so she's somewhere in the middle. Her elbow's not sort of jutting out as a lot of the men we see depicted are. But it's, she's not positioned like a typical woman would be. And in my opinion too, that book at the back is likely an indication, it's symbolic of the fact that she's literate, which again, most people in the 17th century would not have been. So it's likely a Bible. So again, it's sort of an indication of her faith, because Protestantism, of course, is about doing away with this intermediary of a priest and just having one's own relationship with the word in the Bible, but likely she is also able to read. One of the things that this painting makes me reflect upon, and I think especially during COVID times, this kind of problem has really come to the fore, is that how mental health can so much be linked to social status. I mean, I think in this case, you know, her grief is real and palpable, but at the very least, you know, she's going to be taken care of financially. And that's not the case with everybody. And I think so much of the mental health crisis we're seeing now, and the rise in addiction in a city like, an overdose in a city like Toronto, definitely has sort of class at the core of it oftentimes. And even when we think about something like mental health or mental illness and diagnoses, so often, you know, those who don't have access to professional help, or those who are, you know, working three jobs to make ends meet and not sleeping well, that can take a toll on one's mental health. And I certainly think that, yeah, that there's some kind of social structure and class analysis to apply when we take a closer look at causes of mental distress and anxiety. And this painting makes me reflect on that oftentimes. The second work that I decided to share with everybody today is this one here, and it's by Augustus John, and it's called The Marchesa Casati. Now, I want to take a look at this piece too from a bit of a class perspective, but before doing so, I think it's important to provide a little bit of background on this Marchesa Casati. Unlike the woman with the handkerchief in the Rembrandt painting, we actually know quite a bit more about the Marchesa Luisa Casati's life. She was also someone who lived. She's not a fictional character, and there have been many biographies written about her, a few films made, and she really was quite the presence during her day. Now, she was an Italian princess, essentially. She was born into a very wealthy family, and unfortunately her parents died when she and her sister were quite young. And so they ended up inheriting all of this wealth at a very young age. And they didn't quite know what to do with it. And so Luisa Casati here ended up having these very lavish parties and kind of inviting anybody who was anyone. Proust was there, and Picasso, and all the artists and poets. It was sort of the place to be if you were anywhere within the arts and culture realm. Again, similar to the Rembrandt painting, one of the things I love to do when touring with groups to this work of art is to just ask them to throw out some adjectives that they'd use to describe this woman before knowing her life story. And often the response that I get is that she appears bold or confident, fiery, often intimidating. I think, again, you can see part of that comes from her posture, this sort of, she does have this elbow, this kind of like triangular sort of elbow shape that again was associated with masculinity and power. She's also looking directly at the viewer. She seems to expect something from us or be asking something of us. And this would have been quite unique in terms of portraiture at the time. This work of art currently is hung in the AGO's sort of early modern gallery that's about the changing role of women in society in the early 20th century. And I love the way that that room is curated because the Marchesa Cazzati is sort of staring down all of the other women in that particular room. And we have, you know, a painting by an artist named Hammershoy, who frequently depicted his wife, but we never actually see her face. You just kind of see her back looking at the dinnerware. We have a Picasso, Fernand Olivier, who is one of his first girlfriends. But she looks, again, very demure. Her eyes are cast down. She certainly doesn't seem quite as empowered or confrontational as Luisa Cazzati does. And so she really, in this gallery, she really does sort of pull our focus when you walk through there and seem to offer something very different than women, the ways that women were commonly depicted. So she also, you know, wanted to get a lot of attention throughout her lifetime. And in addition to these extravagant parties, she would do these kind of wild things. She had these pet cheetahs that she actually painted bright blue and that she adorned with diamond collars. And she was known to basically take them for walks while she herself would be wearing nothing except this kind of fur coat that was open in the front and a live boa constrictor around her neck. Some historians and kind of culture writers have referred to her as sort of the Lady Gaga or the Paris Hilton of her time. But based on the stories I've read, I'd say she's certainly even more eccentric than them and really sought to live her life artistically. She also had pet peacocks, these white peacocks. And she also had these birds, these albino blackbirds, that depending on the theme of whatever party she was holding, whatever week, she would dye different colors. She was also, very interestingly, obsessed with her own immortality. And this is part of the reason that she commissioned so many paintings and sculptures of her own image. So in the case of the work we're looking at here, this is, again, by Augustus John, who is a very famous artist at the time, also one of her lovers, one of her many lovers. And she would frequently hire, you know, the most famous paintings and sculptors to recreate her image in bronze or oil or whatever the medium may be. And because she sort of figured that the more images of her that were out there, the more she could actually live on, even after her physical death. And in some ways, this actually sort of worked. And I'll get to why we have so many of her paintings now kind of scattered around the world a little bit later. But it is important to note that after the Virgin Mary, the Marchesa Luisa Cazzati is the secondly most common depicted woman in all of Western art history. So she did sort of achieve this objective of immortality in her own way. Now, she's also gone on to inspire essentially tons of fashion designers and other celebrities today. And I think, again, a lot of what we celebrate in her comes down to a question of class. So you can imagine that, you know, seeing somebody in downtown Toronto, perhaps where the AGO is located, where I live, doing something similar, walking down the street, you know, pretty much nude with pet blue cheetahs with diamond collars. If you knew who they were, and if you knew they had a certain amount of social status and wealth, and you know you had been keen to go to one of their amazing parties, you might think, okay, well, that's eccentric, and we'd be allowed to label it as such. Whereas if someone didn't have that kind of class and maybe weren't, you know, didn't have a pet with diamond collars, but were engaging in similar sorts of behavior, you could imagine might be very differently treated, perhaps arrested, perhaps, you know, taken into some sort of psychiatric facility against their will. And so I find, as fascinating as her life really is to me, and I kind of can't get enough of reading about it and the things she did and the way she was, it also does make me reflect again on class, and especially when it comes to mental health and mental illness diagnoses. What in some folks we are quick to consider eccentric and sort of celebrate certain behaviors, whereas in others they could be deemed as frightening or threatening, or we tend to pathologize the actions or behaviors instead. And so I find her life an example of that. Now, unfortunately for Louisa Cazzati, things didn't end very well. Essentially, the 1930s and the Depression meant that she was left almost destitute. She'd sort of spent all of her money, and the creditors came knocking. And because she didn't have any more money to pay off her debts, they essentially started confiscating these very beautiful paintings and sculptures by some of the most famous artists in the world at the time. And that really helped pay off her debts. And so then you can imagine how these paintings sort of were bought and sold and rebought and sold and essentially spread around the world. And that ended up meaning that, you know, she kind of had to abandon her palaces. She had several. If anybody watching has perhaps visited Venice, you might have also visited the beautiful Peggy Guggenheim Museum. Once upon a time, that was actually one of Marchesa Cazzati's own palaces. And she ended up moving to London, reportedly sort of living in this one-bedroom flat, and people saw her kind of scrounging around in the dumpsters for something to eat and for different pieces of fabric in order to continue creating some of her amazing and wild clothes. And I think it's just also an extraordinary work of art to take note of. There's something really powerful about being in her presence in this room, if you were to visit her at the AGO. And I think I also just want to remind everybody that the gallery is open now a few days a week. So please do feel free to come and visit and explore more works in our collection. And we also have a lot more going on with our virtual access programs. And so you're always welcome to tune into our Access to Art page on the AGO website for more programming like this. So thank you again so much for joining us today. I really appreciate it. And I look forward to seeing everybody again soon. Bye.